In this webcast, we're going to be looking at a different type of electron source, one that you may not be entirely used to seeing, but we'll discuss it here. And that electron source is the sigma bond. And the way a sigma bond can act as an electron source is through hyperconjugation. We talk about the rotational barrier for ethane. And according to Bruce, in the fourth edition, these electrons in the CH bond will repel the electrons in another CH bond if they get too close together, based on steric interactions. They'll have an eclipsing interaction. They will repel each other by sterics. However, in an article published in Angewandt in 2002, this was argued to be incorrect. So Paulo Bruce actually changed that incorrect response and changed it to the energy difference between the staggered and eclipsed forms of ethane comes from the stabilizing interaction between the CH sigma bond on one carbon and a CH sigma star antibonding orbital on another carbon. Moving the electrons from the filled bonding orbital partially into that unoccupied antibonding orbital helps stabilize this form. So we'll go into exactly how that occurs right here by looking at the staggered form of ethane versus the eclipsed form. So first we're looking at the staggered form here. We have a filled orbital, a filled bonding orbital between a 1s orbital on hydrogen and an sp3 orbital on carbon, so our sigma bond. And now on the carbon adjacent to it, that's CH bond, we're looking at our sigma star, our 1s from our H, and the negative of our sp3 orbital from our carbon. This is our empty orbital. And we see we have this pi type overlap between our filled sigma and our empty sigma star. It's lined up perfectly in the pi type fashion for this sigma to sigma star donation. This donation helps stabilize this form. Now, to see just look at the stabilization, we need to look at the eclipsed form to see whether there are any of those interactions in that eclipsed form. Looking at it here, the sigma star orbital is flipped around 180 degrees, and we don't have adequate overlap between our orbitals. Since there's no orbital overlap, we don't have an energetically favorable conformation. No overlap based on what we learned on sheet one, this would be a symmetry disallowed conformation. So by looking at this, if we were to draw arrows for this, we could potentially do it. And bear with me for a quick second here. So if we draw this arrow coming from our CH, from our sigma, form a double bond, and kick off an H minus here, we can form this resonance structure here at the bottom. Now, based on our definition of resonance, all that matters is that the electron configuration changes, but the atoms remain spatially the same. They do not move their locations in space. And what we see here is this hydrogen on this H plus and this H minus, same location. They did not move their location in space. So since they did not move, none of the rest of the carbon atoms moved as well. Only the electronic configuration changed. So therefore, based on our definition of resonance, this is indeed a resonance structure. We have valid Lewis structures as well, didn't violate any rules. And this is a special type of resonance which we call double bond, no bond resonance. We formed a double bond here in the middle, and then no bonds between our carbon and our hydrogen. We'll see some more examples of double bond, no bond resonance, but this is where it comes from. Now, the allylic group is another form of showing our sigma bond as an electron donor, electron source. Now, here we have this carbon-hydrogen bond in blue right here. This bond is longer than what you would normally expect for a carbon-hydrogen single bond. And the reason for that, we'll show you in just a quick second here. We can draw this double bond, no bond resonance structure shown here on the right. Draw our arrow coming from our CH single bond, make a double bond, push our electrons onto the right carbon. We've drawn a satisfactory Lewis structure. Everything looks fine. Everything's valid. And our atoms did not move their spatial locations. So all our atoms are in the same place. The electronic structure changed. So this is a valid resonance structure. We have, once again, our double bond, no bond resonance. Now, if we look at the orbital overlap to see whether this was indeed indeed capable of occurring. We have a CH sigma bond here, shown as sp3 orbital. It's lined up to be right in line with our pi star orbital, shown there on our alkene. So, therefore, there's adequate pi type overlap between our sp3 bond and then our pi star orbital as well. Therefore, it does occur. We have this sigma to pi star donation. So we saw a sigma to sigma star on the top, sigma to pi star here at the bottom. Another one is our sigma to A, our last type of sigma bond acting as an electron source. And that can help, we can use that to help explain carbocation stability. Now, this is something you guys learned in Chem 232, or in your first semester organic chemistry course if you didn't take it here. And if we wanted to compare an ethyl cation with a methyl cation. Now, this ethyl cation here on the left is more stable than the methyl cation on the right. And the reason for that is there are more substituents around this carbon. The more substituents makes it more stable. Now, that stability was explained by hyperconjugation briefly in Chem 232. What we can do is we can draw this double bond, no bond resonance structure once again. Taking the electrons from this carbon-hydrogen single bond here on the left, putting them locally, making a pi bond here between our two carbons, our nuclei, their nuclear positions remain fixed. They did not move, only the electronic configuration changed, so therefore this is a valid resonance structure. So because we have this valid resonance structure, this hydrogen here is more acidic than it would have been previously. So therefore, this hyperconjugation is this donation from this bonding orbital here, this sp3 bonding orbital shown here, into this empty p orbital here on our neighboring carbon. So this donation, we can draw our arrow in our double bond, no bond resonance case. We can also just look at this donation coming from our bonding orbital into our empty orbital. And we see we have this, once again, a pi-type overlap. A pi-type overlap helping stabilize that neighboring positive charge. And the more substituents that you have neighboring that empty p orbital, the more orbitals can line up in a pi-type fashion and help stabilize that empty orbital. Now, looking over at this methyl cation, there's no hyperconjugation possible. We don't have a neighboring sigma orbital that can donate into that empty p orbital in a pi-type fashion. All we have are these orbitals here. Nothing in a pi-type fashion can actually overlap and help stabilize that orbital. So this is the reason why more substituents around that carbocation make it more stable.